Thanks, Marilyn, and thank all of you for being here today. With that introduction, you may think that I have an expertise in HR, which I do not. I can only tell you that when my colleague Tara volunteered me for this and I agreed and then started thinking about it, I felt a little like the famous Admiral Stockdale. Do you remember him? He was the vice presidential nominee that ran with Ross Perot, and he was famous for opening the vice presidential debate by saying, "Who am I and why am I here?" So I did a little bit of surveying. There's a lot of literature out there about mentoring, what it means to be an effective mentor and mentee. And I stopped looking because I know that that's what you're going to hear about later on in the sessions. But I did learn something. I learned that the word mentor is actually after a real person in the classic story about Odysseus. The mentor was the person that Odysseus entrusted his son with when he went off on his epic journey. So the word trust is a very important word when you think about what the relationship is between a mentor and a mentoree, and I will return to that shortly. So I'm not an expert, but I can tell you that whenever you think about these things, it's important to think about first principles. And here at Harvard, we do have those. I'm not talking about slogans. I'm not talking about branding. I'm talking about what values exist here at the university that inform our work. And so the first thing you think about when you think about first principles is our mission statement, which is excellence in research and teaching. That does not just apply to faculty and students. It applies to staff, and it applies to people at all levels of our organization. We are a community of learners. And as Marilyn just said, okay, we have so many opportunities available to people to avail yourself of learning opportunities, formal and informal. We have the Bridge Program. We have the Center for Workforce Development, where you can polish your skills. We have the Extension School, the Summer School. We have HarvardX. There are hundreds of thousands of people all over the world who enroll in courses that are free, HarvardX, available to you. We also have a whole panoply of lectures and special events. And so if you are an intellectually curious person, if you are ambitious, if you are a self-starter, this is a great place to work. The problem is, of course, it's an embarrassment of riches. You don't know where to start first. But I would say start with something that interests you. I was thinking about this the other day. Let's say you're a gardener, like you like gardening. Well, there's the arboretum. We have a forest in Petersham. We have a landscape design program at GSD. We have Mount Auburn Cemetery, which in addition to being a cemetery is a beautiful botanic garden. These are all run by Harvard people. And if you get out and you are interested, you get to not only learn about the content of what they do, the herbarium is another, but you meet people along the way. So I really encourage you to think creatively about really taking this place and trying to understand what it's all about and how it aligns with your professional career interests and personal skills, because it is really a great opportunity to partake in what I just said is a learning environment. The second principle is one of One Harvard. You hear that a lot now these days. In some ways, it has superseded the old adage, every tub on its own bottom, which used to be the way this place worked, which meant that each school had its own independent silo and was unto itself. Well, thank you, Drew Faust, because I think she recognized that the most interesting intellectual challenges today are often found at the intersection of disciplines. And our students and faculty are interested in working at the intersection of disciplines because that's where the problem solving, the most challenging problems are. If we're trying to train our next generation of leaders, they really need to collaborate across disciplines. That's true of all of us, too. What it means is get out from behind your desk. My favorite thing that I say to my colleagues in the marshal's office is, why would anybody put your thing, your request, at the top of their to-do list if you've never met them, if you've never looked at them? You don't know who they are. They're just an email exchange. You need to actually build relationships with people. Harvard works as a network. But even apart from your own career ambitions, it's really interesting to meet other people around the university. Have a cup of coffee. Go to events. One of the things that we do in the marshal's office is try to figure out what's happening around the university, because part of the job, as Marilyn mentioned, is that we greet people from around the world who come to Harvard and want to learn about some aspect of how we do higher education or a particular thing. So every summer, we make it a point to go and visit different places. And we have visited a lot of different places. We've visited Harvard X. We've visited Mount Auburn Cemetery. We've looked at the scientific instruments collection. We've gone to the map collection. We have 500,000 maps, one of the largest collections in the world. We have done all kinds of things like that. And in doing so, not only do you learn about the university, but you meet people. And you meet interesting people. And guess what? They love it when you express an interest in something that they're doing. People are very hospitable here. They're very open and eager, you know, because, again, we're a learning community, to tell you and show you about things that we do. We went to the new Harvard Art Museums that advertises the fact that anybody in the university or beyond can make a request to view a work of art. So, of course, we wanted to test that to see if it was real. And sure enough, you know, they brought out three things that we had requested to view, and we had a curator who told us about them. These are things that are available to you. And I encourage you to figure out with either yourself on your own or with friends or to organize something in your department how to really take advantage of these opportunities. The third thing I would say is that enduring motto, Veritas. We've all heard it. It's more than just a motto. It really is something that informs the way we do our business. And I know it means truth, but if you think of it in a broader way, it really means integrity. And I would encourage everybody to realize, especially in this era of fake news and alternative facts and whatever else you want to say, it's really important that you build a reputation for being trustworthy, for being honest, for being fair, because that's the basis on which you build relationships. And I know it should go without saying, but I'm going to say it, because in this brave new world, we shouldn't take it for granted. So those are the three operating principles that I would say are important. And now I have to remember where my place is, because I've yakked on and on. Okay, so another thing I would say is that in running these events that Marilyn mentioned over the years, I've learned something really important about how people really want to be part of something bigger than themselves. And it's a source of great pride to me that all of these things that I've been able to execute with the help of others really have depended on volunteers. All of commencement depends on people who are in the staff, but also people who are stepping up to volunteer to help. And there are a million ways that you can do that. That's also true of the things that we've done with the development office. And it's really wonderful to be able to step up and volunteer to do something that's outside of your job description. And I find that here at Harvard, honestly, when you ask people to volunteer, you almost always can depend on them to deliver. We have high standards. People want to meet those standards. And as I say, they really want to be part of something larger than themselves. So I would look for opportunities to do that. There are lots of different ways you can do it. We can do volunteer work in the community, which I think is very important because Harvard has an obligation to our community, or we can do it internally. There are a lot of ways to do it. You can be a freshman advisor. You can work on some of these special events that I mentioned. You can work through the Phillips Brooks House. There are all ways that you can learn about the enterprise and build relationships that can turn into mentee-mentoring relationships. So, the other thing I would say is that I asked my staff if they would offer some other suggestions based on the what I just talked about. Are there any other things that are important to know about the mentoring and mentee relationship? And I thought the feedback was really very good. One of the things that you have to realize when you're looking for a mentor is that it's a professional relationship. You're looking for somebody who is willing to spend the time with you to advise you on your career goals and your aspirations. It isn't your best buddy. It isn't somebody that your psychiatrist, although we all may need one of those every once in a while. It really is a professional relationship, and there are boundaries to the professional relationship that you have to observe, and I think that that's a good point. Another characteristic that you're looking for in a mentor is somebody who's a generous listener, who really can absorb what it is that you're trying to tell them about yourself and what you're looking for, but isn't going to prescribe the thing from the handbook, isn't going to be the authority figure in that role, is really going to listen and try to take in what it is that you're interested in and give you the best possible advice, but really it's more like leading from behind than it is giving you the solution, because often there isn't an easy solution. And I think that's very important. And finally, you know, I think we all have benefited from being a mentee. Almost everybody I know can think of somebody, a teacher, a relative, somebody who's actually taken an interest in you and helped you think through and advance your goals. And so if you have benefited from that kind of a relationship, it's a good thing to pay it forward. Everybody has the compassion and the skills, if they care to dig deep, to actually help the next person. And there's a lot of fulfillment in that kind of thing, and I encourage you to think about ways that you can do it. So I am going to end by telling you just one story from my not-so-brilliant but checkered career here at Harvard, and it has to do with when I started. I started working here in 1976. It's very important to think about what it was like at Harvard in 1976. The first time that I went into the conference room in the Perkins room, everybody was smoking, everybody was white, everybody was a male. And when I walked in, and they all stood up. That's what 1976 was like at Harvard. Okay, nobody stands up anymore or smokes. And it looks a little different there. So I was hired by the then Vice President for Government and Community Affairs, and my very first assignment was to write a report for Derek Bach on the giving patterns of 25 years of foundations that had funded higher education. I knew nothing about foundations. I thought foundations were bras and girdles. 1976. Okay, or the concrete that you pour to build a house. I had no idea what a foundation was, and I was scared out of my mind. But I decided, you know, I just have to do my best. So I holed myself up. I got 25 years of annual reports from the four different foundations. I looked at all of the financials. I tried to figure out what was going on. When I had a baseline of information, I went around and I interviewed people here at Harvard and elsewhere. And then I learned how to do graphs without any technology. There was no desktop technology. So I finally submitted the report, and I got back a little note from the president that said, good job. and I was thrilled. Okay, and that launched my career at Harvard in the Office of Government and Community Affairs. And I had a mentor as a boss. I was very fortunate because I paid my dues, I worked hard. One of my jobs was to do community affairs, which meant I went out to community meetings at night when we were building a lot of stuff in Cambridge and everybody out there was looking to throw rotten tomatoes at me. So, I mean, it was a hard job. But he put me, he gave me an opportunity to go to the business school to do an executive education program, and he allowed me to work part-time to get my graduate degree at the Kennedy School. So I was very grateful to him. And then I got a promotion, and my promotion was to be the Director of Community Affairs. So I was thrilled until I looked at the budget, and I saw that there was a gentleman who was reporting to me that was making a lot more money than I was. And so I had this awful, you know, sinking feeling. What am I going to do? Here's a guy who has really been in my corner, okay, building, helping me build my career, and should I just ignore that, or should I go and talk to him? And this is where the mentoring, mentee, the trust thing comes in, where you feel comfortable that you can communicate something. So I went and I screwed up all my courage, and I went and I met with him, and I explained, you know, that I was grateful for the promotion, and I was going to work hard, and I was thrilled. And I noticed, however, you know, that there was somebody reporting to me that was making more money. And he said, oh, well, I mean, you know, he's the breadwinner in his family. He's, you know, he has four children. And, you know, I had to look at him and say, you know, I'm not asking you to lower his salary. I'm asking you to raise mine. And I got the raise. Okay. So the point of my story is that, you know, the mentor-mentee relationship is real. It's built on trust. It's built on your ability to actually earn and pay your dues. You know, don't be in a big hurry to go to the next thing until you've actually mastered the skills and experience that says you have a reputation for doing the job well. Work hard, but keep your eye on the big picture. Think about what you'd like to do next. And I personally, when I hire people, I have that conversation right up front. I say, you know, these are jobs. You have a lot to learn here. They're not careers. And so if you do your job well, you can count on me to really help you figure out what's next. But you have to do your job well, and you have to perform at the highest level possible. And then I'm in your corner for the next big thing. So thank you very much, everybody, for having me, and enjoy the rest of the day. Your seminars look really good, and I'm glad to be here to launch them. Thanks.